California, a golden state, home to Hollywood, endless beaches, and sunshine. Unfortunately, those famous blue skies and beaming sun are starting to take a serious toll. California's been officially in a drought for 15 of the past 20 years. However, the state's been pretty much in a constant state of some form of drought for more than 100 years. And now, experts are warning California could be entering a period of mega drought, basically defined as a prolonged period of dryness and low rainfall that damages crops and causes shortages. That's what drought is defined as. California is certainly going through this right now, with its average temperatures rising, and it's hard to imagine how this cycle is going to change in the immediate future. The majority of the state is officially in a drought, with over 37 million people living in drought-affected areas. 80% is classified as being in extreme drought, quote-unquote, while almost a quarter of the state is in a highly serious, exceptional drought. The state's six warmest years on record have all occurred since 2014. In 2020, Death Valley reached 54 degrees Celsius, while Los Angeles recorded its hottest ever day at 49 degrees Celsius. Over the past 30 years, average rainfall has dropped from 430 millimeters per year to around 200 millimeters. November used to signal the start of the rainy season, but now it's regarded as a dry month. With drought comes plenty of serious issues. Firstly, the agricultural industry has been smacked hard. California is one of America's biggest producers of fruit and vegetables. The state grows over one-third of the nation's vegetables, and almost 70% of America's fruit and nuts. With drought severely affecting crops, farmers are forced to cull crops and fallow their land, which is a heartbreaking decision. Fallowing land means to leave a field uncultivated in hopes that it will regenerate after it receives more water. Farmers look to an uncultivated field, and they can't help but think of the money they're losing on crop sales. Estimates put annual unused farmland in California to be about 500,000 acres. Drought also means drier land and flora, which is a huge danger for wildfires. 2020 was a nightmare for California. The state is already notorious for its wildfires. However, 2020 broke all of the records. Over 4 million acres of land was lost, and relief, that cost ran up to $1 billion. Perished homes and buildings ran into the tens and thousands. 2021 was no better, and nearly half of California's worst ever wildfires had taken place over the last 2 years. Aside from the massive costs and loss of land and property, the toll on the wildlife was also very significant. Drought also reduces the availability of fresh water. Millions of Californians have suffered from shortages of quality water for drinking, cooking, and sanitation. Basic stuff. There are several factors at play for this seemingly never-ending drought. Some can be addressed, while others just gotta be adapted to. Warmer temperatures are both human-caused and brought about by natural patterns. California is one of the United States' driest regions, with one quarter of it being a desert. Now, this is a big place, with a lot of people going to lots of places and producing lots of things. It's America's most populous state and the world's fifth biggest economy. So, think about that for just a minuto and imagine the carbon outputs that come as a result of it. Human-caused carbon outputs in California are what you might expect. Almost a third comes from vehicles, with half coming from industry and power consumption. Understandably, the state is focused on reducing greenhouse emissions urgently, and the immediate goal is to reduce emissions to 40% below the 1990 levels by the year 2030. Human-caused temperature and increases in global warming in general are problematic. However, California is also struggling with that lack of rain, like the point of this entire video has been. The Golden State is highly dependent on winter precipitation to fill its reservoirs, to fill its rivers and its basins. A crucial part of this precipitation comes from snowpacks. Snowpacks are the accumulation of mountain snow that store water until they melt in late spring and summer. However, if the snowfall is lower and if winter months are additionally warmer, this severely reduces the amount of available water. By the time August and September come around, the snowpack reserves have long since been used up. The increasing temperatures raise the lowest level at which snow can fall, which means that California gets its highest water precipitation more often in the form of rain than snow. Which might sound fine, but rainfall is either too soon consumed or it just evaporates. It's like coming across just unexpected cash in the street. It's great, but you'd spend it on the first grocery store purchase you are. You're like, oh man, I got this extra $20. I'm going to buy chocolate bars, and boom, it's gone. Snowpacks are like your bank savings nest egg that you keep saved up for emergencies. Another problem is that it's known as evaporative demand or atmospheric thirst. Increased temperatures bring about warmer air, which can hold more moisture. This thirsty atmosphere is literally drinking up moisture from the land and then rendering it even drier and more prone to fire dangers. The warmer air then speeds up the evaporation process. Think of a spilled glass of water and mopping it with a tissue as opposed to a thick sponge. The sponge symbolizes California's current thirsty atmosphere. California is heavily reliant on atmospheric rivers to help relieve drought. An atmospheric river is basically a huge stream of water vapor that is sucked away from the equator and transported somewhere else, like the west coast of the United States. They are huge. Sometimes they are hundreds of thousands of kilometers long and can certainly play a role in delivering the much-needed H2O to California. The only problem is when they don't come, or even worse, when they're too big and they create flooding. The people of California have honestly accepted their fate. They live in a dry state, and it's likely to get drier. I will say that they are a determined lot, though, and are putting in plans to help them manage periods of drought better. Which means focusing on the management and proper use of water. Environmentally driven technology can bring some exciting innovations. These include recycling wastewater, capturing and reusing stormwater, and desalinating seawater. 60% of California's population lives in Southern California, and they depend on their water to be transported in or purified. The main source of water is from the Colorado River. Almost 1 billion liters of water is delivered daily from the Colorado River into the greater Los Angeles area. Another major source for Southern California comes from the State Water Project. This diverts water from Northern California's Feather River to the heavily populated southern regions. The State Water Project is also a major supplier of water for agricultural centers and Silicon Valley. California knows not to rely on Mother Nature. Already, Orange County has initiated one of the world's biggest water purifying centers. Every day, the groundwater replenishment system pumps 400 million liters of purified water into recharge basins. The water is then sent to water delivery centers where the water is purified again before delivery for retail consumption. Capturing and purifying stormwater is another project that is going to be of massive importance to the region. Of course, drought isn't just restricted to California, and the Middle East, and Australia, and countries in Southern Asia. They've all adapted desalinization technologies in their efforts to deal with the challenges of droughts. Californians are doing it tough, but they're not going anywhere. They're simply adjusting, refocusing, and innovating. And of course, hoping for a little rain.